Okay, that basically ends all the introductory parts. Now you really get to the core and nitty-gritty of why you're here. With the first of 4 days, our first lecturer will be Guy Teltsur. Guy has a BSc in Physics from Tel Aviv University and an MSc and PhD in Physics from the Weizmann Institute of Science. He's a researcher at the Israeli government and an external lecturer at the Ben-Gurion University ECE department, where he teaches parallel processing and parallel and distributed computing courses. His interests are in parallel computing, cloud computing, HPC, scientific computing, and information security.
Hello, everyone. Hank mentioned before that Israel sadly does not have a supercomputer. But we have a lot of parallel computers everywhere. For example, this laptop is a parallel machine. It has a processor called i7 with 8 cores, and it has a GPU accelerator from NVIDIA, GeForce something. So it's a parallel machine. And if I do not know anything about parallel programming, I cannot use it effectively. So the supercomputers are the high-end machines, but what we are going to discuss in this tutorial is also relevant for the low-end, for simple workstations, laptop. And of course, we can grow and scale it to clusters and supercomputers. So the slides of this tutorial are available, and I think you have the link. But I made some updates. So please check if you have the latest version. If not, you can download it from here. And there's minor changes, not significant. So I will try to update or maintain this presentation from this website. And this is my email, so you can also catch me later. Please feel free to ask questions during this tutorial. I will be happy to see you learning, so don't be shy and ask questions. We will start with a general introduction to parallel computing. So I assume that it's an introductory tutorial. No prior knowledge about parallel computing is needed. And then during the second part, we will get focused into MPI. And finally, we will do some hands-on practice at the third section. Okay, so let's start. Okay, so I covered that. We'll take a break and then we will continue with MPI and hands-on during the last hour. Okay, so introduction to parallel programming. So these are the topics that I would like to cover. We will introduce the basic terminology, the terms, the metrics, how we measure performance. We will discuss a little bit the architecture of parallel systems, software, hardware, and topology. So all the basic concepts, which are very important to understand this material, will be covered during the first part. So if you go to dictionary and look for the definition of parallel programming, you will see that everywhere they say that it's a matter of computing that with two or more tasks simultaneously. So this is parallel programming or parallel computing. And there is also another term, which is called parallel processing, which is quite similar. And I will probably use all the terms randomly. But I think parallel processing is somewhat broader, has a broader scope than parallel computing. Because when we talk about parallel computing, we discussed about the computation element, which is the CPU. And parallel processing is parallelizing everything in the system where we have bottlenecks. So if we have bottlenecks in the storage, we will discuss parallel file systems. If we have bottlenecks in the visualization, we'll do parallel visualization. And you can see tile displays sometimes when the bottlenecks is the amount of pixels that you need to process. So parallel processing is maybe a broader term, but we will use it interchangeably during this tutorial. If you look about on the topics of the IT or computer science, you will see that parallel and distributed computing is among the topics that are being covered everywhere, starting from the middle of the 60s and starting from the academia, then the industry. And parallel computing now is, as I said, is common, is everywhere. When I started to work in this field, it was dubbed rocket science because it was very rare. But these days, parallel computing is everywhere, even in our cell phones. Maybe the most modern term which covers also parallel and distributed systems is the cloud computing, but we will not discuss it too much here. If you look at in this 2D map where we have the number of tasks, parallel tasks, on one axis and the amount of data volume on the other axis, we can try to understand where we are working when we say parallel computers, which is maybe the somewhat lower volume of data. This scale maybe is not so up to date. You can multiply it by a factor of 10 and it's to be maybe more up to date. But when we say parallel computing, we mean a system which is close together. The computation elements are close to each other. Because MPI, which we will introduce later, the message passing interface library, is very sensitive to latency and bandwidth. And so we cannot go to large volumes, which also mean further distance between the computing elements. And large data volumes, which is called also big data, is done on the clouds, as I said before, and on the grid systems. And another family of computations is what is called embarrassingly parallel computations. Computations which are loosely coupled, and there is not much dependencies between the tasks that we compute. Okay, so why do we need a parallel computing? So here you can see three examples of a family of computations where parallel processing or computing is a must. So it was mentioned earlier, weather simulation is a good example for parallel computing. And why is that? So we will see a slide about it later on, and I'll explain it in further detail. Image processing, or whenever we have sensors which collect a huge amount of data and we need to analyze it, it's a good candidate for parallel computing as well. And there is a family of computational X, or under the umbrella of scientific computing applications, where X can be physics, chemistry, biology, whatever. It is said that traditionally science is consist of theory and experiment, but since the 60s of the, as I mentioned before, science also has the computational pillar. And this new branch is done only on high-end machines which are parallel. So we do a parallel processing in order to get to the solution faster and or to solve bigger problems. These are the two main motivations for parallel computing. And this is carried out by two families of systems. The first one, which was mentioned the whole day, is the high-performance computing. The goal of high-performance computing is to deliver as many as possible numerical operations per second. On the other hand, there is another family of computations, which was not mentioned today, the high-throughput computing. The goal here is to deliver a lot of computations, but on very large time scales, for weeks and even months and years. And then we have different considerations. We don't care too much about operations per second, but maybe operations per year. And fault tolerance and high availability are more significant and dominant in these kinds of computations. And these are carried out usually on grid systems. And the big data, which is the big data mining, is a combination of all the above. So we'll be focused in this tutorial on the high-performance computing. So example about the memory bottleneck. I don't know how many of you are familiar with MATLAB, but there is a small program here, 6 lines of code, that do matrix multiplication. Generate 2 random matrices of dimension n, and we multiply them, and that's it. Now the question is, how large can n be? So we try it on the machine, and we take n equal to 10, and this is no problem. N equal to 100, to 1,000, no problem with that. But when I put n equal to 10,000, I get a memory exception error. This means that the computer cannot handle this size of matrix. And the question is, so what do we do? Humanity cannot multiply matrices of larger size. Do we have to give up? What can we do with this challenge? So here's another screen capture on this laptop, which is a little bit stronger, but again, it's small here. At some point, the computation will break. And we don't want to give up at 1,000 or 10,000. We want to to be able to multiply any size of matrices. So we need to think how to split the computation among different processors, where the memory space is now becoming larger. And this is the way to handle it. We divide the matrix to submatrices, and we distribute the submatrices to parallel computer, and then we can perform the computation. The second motivation is speed, as I said before. And in all these fields, speed is, of course, a very important factor. And when we say speed, we need to get proportion. What do we mean by that? So if I'm trying to do weather forecasting on the computer, we need to get the result in a reasonable time. If we want to warn people from a storm, we want to get the answer before the storm hit the shore and people might get hurt. So reasonable time is something that is specific to the problem. In the case of weather forecasting, it should be a few days maybe before the event. And in other cases, it's a different time scale. How do we measure performance of parallel machines? So like in physics, when we have length and time, we define the basic speed for a computation in the term flop. Flop is floating point operation per second, flop. And it's like the speed. It's a division of two numbers. And like in physics, where we have many scales from the elementary particles up to the galaxies, the same in high-performance computing. We have many scales of computations, and these years we are in the petaflop scale. Peta, which you can see the legend on the right, it means 10 to the 15 operations per second. And in about 11 years, it takes us to go 3 orders of magnitude. This is actually the interpretation of Moore's law to supercomputers. And so we heard about it in the morning. There is an expectation to reach the exaflop, the 10 to the 18 operations per second by the end of this decade. And who knows what will be later on. Probably it will, the silicon area will terminate somewhere around that time. So it's not...
The first is the top 500?
This is, it's a typical number from the first, the ranked number one in the top 500, yeah. So for example, in 1997, it was the ASCII Red machine, and the Roadrunner was the world leader in the 2008, and we will see. Here you can see, by the way, another funny machine. This is a computer that is not parallel, and you see that the performance is very, very poor. On the other hand, it is built from Lego blocks. So it's nice. And if we want to be a good parallel computer users, we need to understand the whole three together. We need to know how to program, but we need to bind it to the topology and the hardware in order to be effective. It's not enough to know MPI if you don't know the topology and the hardware. And they are all combined. So it's a multidisciplinary field. One slide about the topology. As you already heard today, commodity off-the-shelf computers are the building blocks of all the machines today, and they are connected by a network. And there is more than one way to do it. So if our processors will be these circles, we can connect them in many ways. This is called the topology. So for example, here you see computers connected on a line, and if I connect the last one to the first one, it becomes a ring. So it's a circular boundary conditions. This topology, for example, is very good if a machine only needs to communicate with the nearest neighbors. But it is quite bad if I need to send a message from a machine which is further apart.
These machines are in the same site or in different countries?
No. So as I said before, high-performance computing machines are always localized in one place. So it's one site. This topology, however, has two options where to how to communicate to the right or to the left. So maybe this is a benefit. If I do it in a two-dimensional space, then I get a mesh. And if I connect the last machines to the first one in two dimension, I get these torus. And the last case here is the hypercube, where we know a regular cube is a entity where each computer has three nodes, which are nearest neighbors. And in this four cube, there are four neighbors. And how we select the topology, usually we need to identify or understand the algorithm, the problem that we want to solve, and then we can make the best decision about the topology. Usually, supercomputers have some general purpose usage, so they have general purpose network. And sometimes there are two networks on the same machines. One of them is general, and the other one can be these torus or hypercube for specific problems. So, and one slide about the hardware, maybe two slides. So here you see a picture of a typical motherboard of a commodity of the shelf computer. And what we see here is it's very typical. We see here the sockets for the main processors. As we heard in the morning, there can be a Xeon processors by Intel or Opteron by AMD. And here we have the sockets for the memory. We plug in the memory chips. And these are the expansion slots, the PCI slots, where we can put stuck inside accelerators or coprocessors. It's funny, but usually when we say coprocessors, we are referring to the Intel Xeon Phi. And when we say accelerator, it's the NVIDIA GPGPU. So the best accelerator will be by NVIDIA, the best processor will be by Intel, and there is always a winner somehow, one of them. And so this is the Xeon Phi, what also was mentioned in the morning. A single card like this has a computing power of more than one teraflop. Tera is 10 to the 12, like the ASCII RED, which I mentioned before, the world leader in 1997. It was a full building of 10,000 Pentium Pro processors, and now it's in a single PCI card. We can even stack a few of them in a single machine. So let's see, for example, what is the expected performance of such a configuration? Performance, I will explain it further later on, but this is the peak theoretical performance, which means it cannot be stronger than that. It's a theoretical measure. In practical applications, it will be less. So if I have this board, and I put here the typical Xeon processors, not Xeon Phi, with 8 cores each. And you know that the performance is proportional to the frequency or the clock of the processor. And luckily, in each clock, the processor can do more than one operation due to vectorization and parallelization in the architecture of the processor itself. A single socket of this EVBridge processor is 185 gigaflop. Giga is 10 to the 9 operation per second. And since I have two processors, it will be multiplied by 2. Then if I take the Xeon Phi in addition, which is 1.2 teraflop, I can even put four cards like this on that board, so it becomes 4.8 teraflop, and altogether I get more than 5 teraflop on a single server that I can put below my desktop. And this is five times stronger than the ASCII RED, where you see it in the picture. And the price? Well, each Xeon Phi is about $3,000, so it's reasonable. Now, what do we do with these machines? Where are the flops going to? So let's see an example. If I want to compute Newton's first law in one dimension, F equal to ma, force, mass, and acceleration, there is a single operation here. So it's one flop. If I take the formula for the gravitational force between two stars, for example, then again, in one dimension, it would be four operations. If I do it in 3D, it's about 10 operations. So this is between two stars. Now, what will happen if I try to simulate a whole galaxy? In a typical galaxy, there are 10 to the 11 stars. Let's assume that we want to do simulation of the evolution of that galaxy for 100 time steps, which is not much. So we need 100 iterations. And if we do the simulation by the gravitational force, then when we choose a star, we need to compute the force that is exerted on that star from all the rest of the stars. And then we have to repeat it for all the stars, so the complexity, the amount of computation, is proportional to n to the square, and n is 10 to the 11. So if you combine all this, it's 10 to the 11 times 2, 10 to the 22, and additional two orders of magnitude for the computation time. So we ask how long it will take. Suppose we have a 10 gigaflop computer to do it, which is maybe a little bit old desktop or laptop. And we just divide the amount of operations by the computing power, and we see how long it will take. So this will take more than 3 million years. And this is not reasonable. When I said reasonable time, we cannot afford to wait. And then we have two conclusions from this slide. First of all, it will not be useful even to go to parallel machine, which is maybe even 10,000 times stronger. It will not be reasonable as well. The way to overcome this problem is not by brute force just to add more processors. We need to change the algorithm to do some approximation maybe, but to use different algorithm. In specific case of this problem, it can be solved by n log n operations, which is the right way to go, and not n to the square. This is, by the way, called Barnes-Hut algorithm. So parallel computing is not the solution for everything. And first of all, we need to optimize the algorithm, and then to think about how to parallelize it correctly. We saw this graph earlier. It's taken from the top 500. The top 500 is the World Olympics of supercomputers. This ranking is done twice a year, in November in the United States and in June in Germany. And if you go to this site, top500.org, you will see the list of the first 500 machines, stronger machines in the world. How it is being done, this ranking? Well, there is a benchmark. Benchmark is the way computers are measured. Everything actually can be measured according to a benchmark, even cars or whatever. But the specific benchmark here is called HPL, High Performance LINPACK, which is a linear algebra problem. And so the ranking is done according to a single benchmark. There are a lot of criticism about it because, as I said before, maybe if you want to rank cars, it's not fair just to do it according to the speed or the acceleration of the car from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour. Maybe you need to take also into consideration the safety of the car. There are many other parameters that you can judge cars. So the same applies to supercomputers. But for now, it's a single benchmark, this high-performance LINPACK. And what we see here actually is the Moore's law of supercomputers. This is the time, the year in years. And this is the performance of this benchmark. And note that, well, it is cut here. But it's a logarithmic scale. Somehow the projector took the numbers out. But this is a factor of 10, each line here. And we see here three lines. So I explain what they mean. The lower one is the ranking of the number 500. So this is the entry point to the list. And according to the latest results from last November, this conference took place in Denver, Colorado, and it's nearly 100 teraflop is the entry point to the top 500. The second line in the middle is the number one, and this is the Chinese supercomputer with nearly 34 petaflops. And the upper line, is the total or the sum of the whole 500 machines. You can see it in a pictorial way as what we have in Earth, the overall computing power, maybe, of all the supercomputers on our planet. And all of them behave very monotonically, very regularly. So if we fit it, we can also extrapolate and have a prediction about what will happen in the future, assuming the same technology. And this is why supercomputers are so interesting. First of all, they're interested because they are very complex machines, and it's a challenge to build it, to build them and to use them. But they are also interesting because looking on supercomputers today is like looking into the future. So what will happen 10 years from now It means that today technology will be in our laptops in 10 years. So you can predict what will happen and also what will be even in the lower systems, lower-end systems. For example, this laptop, it has a computing power that was 12 years behind in the top 500 list. This is the list of the first 10 entries to the recent ranking of the top 500. And we see that number one is the Chinese computer with the Xeon Phi. It was mentioned earlier today. And it has 3 million cores. The performance is nearly, as I said, 34 petaflops. And the last column here is the power consumption. And it's nearly 20 megawatts of electricity. This means, by the way, that if you will not do anything, just follow this curve, then when we reach the petaflop at the end of this decade, our supercomputers will consume more than 200 megawatts of electricity. And this is, of course, unacceptable to build a power station by the supercomputer. If you look also on this list, you see the dominance of the United States. Most of the machines are IBM, Cray. It's from the United States. There is another one from Japan in the top 10. And this is the first machine, the strongest supercomputer of Europe, in number 6. And there are two entries of the Xeon Phi in the list. Also, the machine from Texas, which was also mentioned earlier today. And it's quite remarkable to see that coprocessor and accelerators are, I think, in most of the machines of the top 10. And this is a new trend. It was not like that a few years ago. Another motivation to go to parallel computing is to enable us to do simulation not only faster or to use a larger memory space, but really it related to the basics of the science. I mean, if we try to do molecular dynamic simulation, which is similar to the problem of the galaxy that we saw before, but with different interaction, instead of stars we have your atoms and the interaction law is different. But if you use too few atoms, like in the slide at the left, we'll get wrong physics. And if you want to reconstruct really what is happening inside the material, we need to use many more atoms. And so we need also to use more processors. Instead of 2,048 processors here, it's 32,768 processors at the right part of the slide. And when we do it in the right granularity, we see the true phenomena of the material. So when you use a grid which is too coarse, we don't reconstruct the real laws of nature. We need to go into a finer level of details. About the terms, basic terms of parallel computing. So here you see the picture of Michael Flynn. And Flynn was the first to give names to the basic types of machines of computer and parallel computers. So let's understand what the Flynn taxonomy means. So the first kind of computer is the single instruction, single data machine. This is actually the serial processor, the serial computer, that when we learn introduction to programming, we actually had imagined this machine. There is a program counter which goes into the instructions one by one, and at each specific moment, one operation is being done, and this is the serial machine. It's the reference point for the other machine. The second one is the SIMD. It's the, what is called vector machine. There is a single instruction, but it can operate on multiple kind of data, like doing mathematical manipulation on an array of numbers. The third type is the MISD. It's not so common. You cannot buy it in a regular shop. It is some kind of a pipeline machine, and we will not cover it in this presentation. The last type is the MIMD, multiple instruction, multiple data, which is the really the general purpose parallel machine that everyone are using today. And the way to program the MIMD or the CMD is by what is called SPMD. We write a single program, and from there we operate all the machinery, all the processors and all our data. It's a single source file. The way to make parallel programs is to write a single program. This is the most common case. A single program where all the instructions are in one source file. You can break it to parts, but conceptually it's one place, one source. Here again is a summary of the four types from Flynn taxonomy. And we'll refer to this model. The general purpose parallel machine, PU is the processing unit, so it acts on different data with different instructions at the same time. Questions? Any questions? Feel free to ask any questions if you have. Okay, so let's try to quantify the things, and let us define serial time and parallel time, and then we try to find some relations between them. So let's define TS, the serial time, is the time for a program to run in a serial machine, that is operation after operation, no parallelization inside. And TP will be the time for the same program to run on a parallel machine. Of course, we expect that T parallel will be smaller than T serial. If this is not the case, then there is no reason to go to parallel programming. We want to do it at shorter times, so this is reasonable to expect.
Time is work clock time.
Yes. Now, there is an interesting case when you have a parallel program, but you degenerate it to a single task. So you write a parallel program, but you use it on a single task. It's like putting P equal 1. In this special case, we usually expect that the parallel code will run slower than the optimized serial program because there is some overhead in the programming that is not maybe being used so well because it's only one process. But we can assume for now that it's equal. A parallel program with one task is like a serial program to first order. Then we define these quantities. First of all, a very important measure is the speed up, or the acceleration, if you would like. It's simply the ratio between the serial to the parallel times. And you immediately notice that the speed up cannot, in usual way, cannot be larger than the number of processors. Well, it's like when you're adding bulbs or lamps, the light, the total amount of light you get is never more than the amount of a single lamp multiplied by the number of lamps. It's a conservation law. Well, there are some exceptions which are second order. It's called the superlinear speed up, but we can now we don't need to treat it now. So first quantity is the speed up. The second one is called work or cost, and it's the multiplication of the number of processors by the time. And maybe it's a good, I will make a drawing on the board what we mean by that. So if we see here, we take the number of processors and the number and the time, then if I multiply them, it's like the area. This is the amount of computation in the problem. If I have one processor, I expect that it will take a larger time. But the area should be roughly the same. And if I have more processors, it will be shorter. But the amount of work is more or less the same up to the efficiencies. As I said, there is some overlap if you go from a single process to many processes. And so this is the this is why it is called work, because it's the, like the area of this. It's a property of the algorithm. If I multiply two matrices, the amount of work there is the number of operations, which is maybe n to the third in case of matrix multiplication. And the final, the last term here, is the efficiency, which is like the ratio between the two definitions of work, serial work divided by parallel work. If this is equal to 1, then I'm very effective, but this is very rare. Usually, when I have more processors, the efficiency will get lower. And there is also a particular case which is called cost-effective. Well, what does it mean? We said that the work is equal to P times dp. In very special cases, if I multiply the number of processors by some number, I get that the computation time is getting shorter by the same factor, then it is said that it is cost effective. But this is very specific case. Typical behavior of the speed up, when we plot it, the speed up is a function of the number of processes. And by the way, notice that I'm using the word processes. Here it is written processors. Later on, maybe we'll use threads, cores. At the moment, let's leave that aside. It's the same. Okay, let's assume that it's the same meaning. So first we noticed what we discussed before, that there is an upper limit to the speed up, which is a 45 degrees slope, which means that it cannot be higher than the number of processors. Now, of course, when we take more and more processors, the speed up is getting saturated at some point. There is no benefit from going from 64 to 128 or even a higher number of processors in this algorithm, in this case, for example. We cannot use, we cannot divide the work to too many processors. There is no work for them to do. And therefore, the speed up is not going infinitely. In addition, we see that we have here three curves. And the governing factor here is called F. This makes the difference between the three cases. And what is this F? It's something theoretical, but it will give us intuition about the behavior of parallel programs. F is the serial fraction of the code which cannot be parallelized. So let's assume that I have a program with 100 lines of code, but five of them are serial, cannot be parallelized. This means that F is equal to 5%. Okay? And then you see that the larger F is, the smaller the speed up. And you cannot you cannot do anything about it. It is getting into this saturation. And this is a property of the program. And this will take us to an important observation, which we'll discuss in the next slide. Similarly, the efficiency is also going down when we increase the number of processors, and also it is also a factor of F. The larger F is, the efficiency will get lower sooner, and it means that very pessimistic, actually, prediction about parallel computing. We heard all the whole day that people use today tens of thousands of processes, millions of processes, and here we see that very quickly there is no point to go to a large number of processes.
Yeah. Actually, one can realize the maximum speed up even from the serial program, because if you know the time it takes for the part that you want to parallelize, if it will be zero if you go to infinitely many processors, then you know from the serial program already what is the maximum speed up.
That's assuming that the communication cost is free.
Yeah, we neglect the communication at the moment. You are very right, and this is exactly you brought us to this slide. Amdahl's law, this is Jean Amdahl, and he did exactly what you said now. So again, it's a bit okay. I don't know how to do it now, but okay. I will explain all the terms here. So we will actually use the serial time and parallel time and this F that we defined in previous slides to get the law of the speed up. So what do we have here? So suppose we have a serial system with a program running on with time TS and the parallel system and it is denoted by TP, and F is the fraction of the code that cannot be parallelized, and P are the number of processors. Then the parallel time can be derived from all the above. What is it? It will be the serial fraction of the code, which run on the F fraction of the line, of the program with time TS. And the other the complementary part, which is 1 minus F, can be accelerated by a factor of P, which is the number of processors. So we get an expression for the parallel time. And if we divide now the two, we get the definition of the speedup. And this is the speed up. This is Amdahl's law about the speed up. And now, what you said before, if we take the number of processors to infinity, we get the upper limit of the speed up. So when the number of processors is getting very high up to infinity, then the maximum speed up will be 1 over F, this fraction. Okay? You see it from here. What does it mean? So I said, let's assume that F is only 5%, which is sounds very reasonable, that 5% of the program cannot be parallel. So what's the big deal? Then it's very pessimistic law, because it means that the maximum speed up is 20. And there is no point to use a huge machine with millions of cores or processes. So why is that? Well, this is true, but it's not... We have to be careful about the interpretation. There is very good motivation to go to parallel machines, and as you all know. And this is because we assume that we run the same program on the serial machine and on the parallel machine, which is wrong. When I go from a serial to parallel machine, I will use bigger program. And bigger program behave differently. So... Before we go further, let's see another example. And it's quite general. This law is quite general. Suppose we have some manufacturing process, okay, that has two components. One of them I cannot do with it anything, but the other part of the process can be accelerated somehow. Then I can define speed up on that process. So, for example, here, in this example, 20% of the mission, of the task, 20% can be accelerated by a factor of 10. And the other 80%, I cannot do with it anything. Then I see already, from the definition of the speed-up, that I can now accelerate this task by 1.25. So it's quite general, this law. Okay, so that was the pessimistic part. Now we will meet John Gustafson, and we see that still there is motivation to use parallel computers. And what is Gustafson's law? It's using the same terminology, but different kind of derivation. Let us now start from the parallel machine. The parallel machine executes the program in time TP. Well, first of all, this is an identity. If you open the parentheses, it's a TP equal to TP. But it's not a game. I mean, TP here is a function of F also. Again, F is the serial part of the code. So if this is the time for the parallel machine, what will be the time of the serial machine running the same program? So first of all, there is this part which I cannot do anything with it because it was serial in the parallel machine. It will be serial also in the serial machine. But the other the complementary part, 1 minus F, now will be P times slower. So there's a factor of P here. Now again, I can use the formula for the speed up, which is T serial divided by T parallel. And when I take these two lines and I divide them one to the other, I see that now the speed up is proportional to P. It's not going to some saturated value, but it will keep going up as I add more processors. This is called the scale speedup. And this is the observation of Gustafson's law. So there is a point to go to bigger machines, and they always be doing better than a single machine. Now, how do we connect the two laws together? So let's review them once again. In the case of Amdahl's law, we had a program that was running on the serial machine on a time, let's normalize it to one units of time. And it has, as we said, two components, serial part and parallel part. The serial part, when I go to parallel machine, is the same. I cannot parallelize it. On the other hand, the parallel part, if I have n processors in this case, it will get shorter by a factor of n. So the parallel time will be this. Okay? And this is Amdahl's law. So the speed up is just the ratio 1 over S plus P divided by N, like it said here. And in the case of Gustafson's law, it's somewhat different observation. We have the parallel runtime on the parallel machine. Sorry, it's here. We can, again, normalize this time to 1. And then we go back to the serial machine and see how long it will take to the serial machine to work. So again, this function is the same. And the other component will be n times slower because it's a serial machine. So the time on the serial machine will be S plus n times P, where n is the number of processors. And this is the scale speedup of Gustafson. So the explanation here is that in the first case, we use the same problem size. And this is when the problem size is too small, really there is a limit to the amount of efficiency is limited when we go to larger computing machines. But if we fix the runtime, we see that we always improve relatively to a serial machine. Another term that we need to know, maybe it's less useful, is the overhead. Overhead is defined by 1 over epsilon. Epsilon is the efficiency, minus 1. And it's actually, what is written here, is the relative difference between the work of the parallel minus work of the serial, divided by the work of the parallel, or serial, sorry. Work of the serial machine is just the time, because there is one process multiplying it. So it's the relative difference in the work. This is called overhead. Another important ratio or term that we need to know is the computation to communication ratio, which we always have to try to maximize. We are interested only in the computation. The communication is like a tax we need to pay. We need it, but it's not our goal. And as we heard in the morning, sometimes when we do communication, we cannot do computation. That's what I'm referring to the talk about InfiniBand. So we need to maximize this ratio. And it's the responsibility of the programmer to do it correctly. And in the second part of the tutorial, we will discuss how to improve this ratio. So speaking about network, it's a good point to mention maybe the first law of networks. It's a first order accurate, but we will use it, and we will need this knowledge for the rest of the tutorial. So when we send message from one process to in the other process, we can estimate how long it will take by knowing two numbers. Now this is, as I said, it's a first order law. It's not maybe completely accurate, but it's a good approximation. And the two parts are, one of them is called latency, and the other one is called bandwidth. Now bandwidth, I guess you all know what it is. If you have Ethernet, maybe gigabit Ethernet, it means you can transfer 10 to the 9 bits per second, or if you have 10 gigabit, it's so forth. If you have InfiniBand, for example, as we heard this morning, the current technology is 56 gigabit per second. Soon it will be 100, later on, next year maybe 200 gigabit per second. So this is the bandwidth. Now what is the latency? Latency is the amount of time we need to spend when we initiate a communication. So it's not related to the size of the message. Each time we need to send something, we need to pay some amount of time. It's also the function of the technology. So typical number maybe for Ethernet can be 10 plus microseconds, and maybe for InfiniBand it's the 1-point-something microseconds. This is why InfiniBand is so popular in supercomputers. There are many times that the communication is dominated by the latency and not by the bandwidth, and the latency of InfiniBand is much better than the latency of Ethernet. So communication time, as we see here in this plot, is first determined by the latency. It's called also startup time. And then it depends on the message size. The slope is 1 over the bandwidth. And if we need to send big message, it will take longer. Small message, it will take less. But always we'll have to pay this latency. You can see it like that. Latency is the time it takes to transmit a message when the message size is approaching 0. This is the latency. If you want to visualize it, you can think about maybe waiting to the light to change from red to green. And when you have a Mercedes that can drive you at 200 kilometers per hour, but if you are stuck in red light, and then you start driving, it takes you a second to wake up, so it's like latency. And another term which is very important in the world of supercomputing, of parallel computing, is the load balance or load imbalance. And we heard about MOSIX in the morning. It's an automatic tool that does load balancing, but the general term refers to this case. So here you see in this plot 8 processes that are running, and there are a few of them that are very busy. And on the other hand, there's one here that is very free, it's not loaded. And as you can imagine, that the overall time of the computation will be determined by the last processor, which will finish its job. And therefore, this problem is not balanced now. However, if you can take these parts of the excess of the load and transfer them to the free processor, we can optimize the time. And again, it's the responsibility of the programmer to take care for that. So we will see soon that when we want to model something or simulate something, we need to divide out the problem space and allocate different parts of the problem to different processors. And the right way to do it is to take the load balance to optimize it, to make it better. And speaking about modeling, when we write a simulation like the weather forecast, which we mentioned before, we need to pass through these stages. I mean, we see a phenomena that we want to model, and then we write the physics laws using mathematics. But computers don't understand the equations. They need to discretize the problem to go to numerical scheme, and then we need to program it. So if we now want to program it with parallel computing, this is the place where we start to divide the problem into pieces which we will allocate them to different processors. And then, of course, all this sits on the hardware and the topology that I mentioned before, which all of them give the optimization of all the stages, give the fastest results, and, of course, the accuracy. The model should be right, not only fast, but also, first of all, it should be right. And when we mentioned the weather forecast, it's a good example for the previous slide. So suppose I want to model what is going on in the atmosphere. First of all, the universe is continuous, is a continuum media, but computers are discrete. So I need to make a mesh and take a sample of the physical world. And in this case, we use a regular mesh with the same spacing. And the amount of computations in this problem is the number of nodes that we have in our mesh. And you see here that 100 kilometers for scale is maybe good for the ocean, but if you want to make the weather forecast for Israel, then if you take 100 kilometers, you miss the whole state. I mean, one point will be in the Mediterranean, the other point will be in Jordan maybe, and there's no result for us to refer to the internal points. So we need to take finer and finer grid or mesh and compute or estimate the physical quantities like pressure, airspeed, humidity, and so forth in each of the points. And when the number of points here become too large, it cannot be solved on a single machine. We need to parallelize it. So the term we will refer is called domain decomposition. We decompose the domain, we divide it, and there are many ways to do it. So in this slide, we saw in uniform division of the domain. But sometimes you can use different kinds of decompositions. This one, for example, is called adaptive mesh refinement. It's a grid that is being divided in a recursive way until the amount of computation is balanced. So if in this region there is nothing physical phenomena are rapidly changing, then the size can be larger. On the other hand, here, the area is smaller because there is a lot of computation to be done. So let's make a simple assumption now. Suppose our domain is a square. This is the area we want to make the weather simulation or whatever it is. And we want to allocate processors to our domain. And here you see two alternatives. One of them is to divide this domain by squares. And in the other one, by strips. Let's assume that the area of a single square is equal to the area of a strip. So as we said before, the amount of computation is proportional to the area. So with that respect, it doesn't matter if we do it with blocks like this or strips like that. It's the same amount of computation. But what about the communication? Here, if we look at an internal point, a grid, internal block, it has four neighbors that this processor will have to communicate with the four neighbors if it's a two-dimensional problem. On the other hand, if we look here on an internal strip, it has only two neighbors. So maybe it's less communication, but on the other hand, I need to send or receive bigger arrays of points. And of course, there is the boundary, which let's assume that it is fixed. So there is no communication between on the edges, on the boundaries. But the computation to communication ratio is different between the two cases. In addition, I can decompose my domain in various ways. Even if I choose to do it with strips, I can do it maybe in some ordering, which is more sophisticated. Again, the motivation here is to improve the load balance. If I do it with very thick blocks, then perhaps some phenomena will make a significant deviation in the amount of computation between these strips. But if I take maybe narrower pieces and I will shuffle it like this, I will improve the load balance. And so you see here schemes according to the dimensionality of the problem, 1D, 2D, and horizontal and vertical splittings, and also in 45 degrees. So let's try to understand where are the problems of parallel computing in that respect. So suppose we want to simulate a car. As we said before, the universe is continuous, but we need to model it in the computer by discretization. So let's think about our car as this, like this, where we have grid points, and all the physical quantities should be computed on these grid points, like the stress and strain, temperature, whatever. Now, if I will make a very refined grid, the number of computations will be very large, and I will have to parallelize it. I will not be able to solve it on a single machine. So we will parallelize it. We will break the car into pieces and we'll decompose it. It's the domain decomposition will give each part of the car the responsibility of different process, like this. And maybe we can see that now we are happy with that, because now the amount of computation per process is much less, and it's solvable. But there is a catch here. And if you look at the slide, you will see the catch. These parts are not independent. Why is that? Because let's look at this point. Physically, this point is exactly here. It's not decoupled. The grid points on which belong to this computer have influence on the physics of that point. But that point appears here in the other computer, and this one is also influenced by the points which are in the responsibility of that processor. They are not independent computations. And when we want to compute the physics of this part and of this part, we need to transfer information between the two parts all the time. And the way to do it is by making some extension of the domain of each process. This is called halos. So what I need to do, if, for example, I assume forces that are affected by nearest neighbors, so the physics that of that point is influenced by the physics of the neighboring points. So before the computation, I send all the information from that process to this process, and I put it here on the ghost points. It is called ghost points. So the information is local now. And similarly, I send from the blue to the red process all the relevant information in order to compute the physics of that point on this processor. And the overall outcome of this is that this is a very high-performance computing problem, because the more points we have more computation. And in addition, we have also a lot of computation in each iteration. In fact, we need to exchange information between neighboring processors. So it's CPU intensive and it's network intensive problem. And it's not a trivial one. A lot of physical simulations are exactly like fit this concept, this model that you see here. If you make it a little bit more arranged into some regular shape, not, you can forget now the car and look at the grid, rectangle grid. So if we allocate process number 0 to this area and number 1 on this area and so forth, then we need to exchange the boundaries of the two neighboring processors before the computation takes place. So you see here, for example, the upper line here is copied to the to be the bottom line of the neighboring process in this direction, and similarly the lowest line of the process number 1 is copied to be the upper level of process number 0 before it can do the computation, because it needs all the information from neighboring points. And similarly in every other dimension, usually it's a three-dimensional problem. So again, the number of computation is proportional to the number of grid points, and the communication is just the edges. And on each iteration, we need to do computation and then what is called send and receive of the these boundary layers between neighboring processes. And this is a grand challenge problem. Another models of parallel computing that should be mentioned. So there are two buzzwords maybe that you should be familiar with. This first one is called task parallel, and here is a pseudocode that represents this case. So we just identify subroutines or functions in the program that can be assigned to different tasks. And if they are independent, they can be executed as a different thread or process. And the overall outcome is that we do it in a shorter time. So this is task parallel. Another kind of decomposition is the data parallel. And we saw before the SIMD, the vector computation. So suppose we have an array arrays that we can split them into parts and allocate each part of these arrays to different processes. So the computation can be done in parallel. This is exactly what we said before, single instruction, multiple data. This is the data parallel versus the task parallel concepts. About what kinds of archetypes of parallel machines we have. So we have what is called distributed memory machines in the left part of the slide. Each CPU has its local memory, and this communication that we saw before takes place over the network. This is very typical to what is called the cluster computing, when we have simple boxes of machines that are connected via Ethernet or InfiniBand, and they do message passing, which we'll learn later on in more detail. The other alternative concept is the shared memory. Shared memory means that the whole global space of the memory is shared among the processes. So there's no need for message passing, no need for communication, because all the information is accessible on this memory.
This is your laptop.
Well, my laptop is a combination. I will discuss it. So this is the classical shared memory concept. And here you can see that the access to the memory is uniform. This is called...
What does it mean that we don't need communication?
You don't need to send and receive messages because all the information...
But I need to put some flags that I had finished computation.
Yeah, you need to lock to protect the variables. But it's not message passing, it's different. Okay. So this is called uniform memory access because the memory is can be accessed in a uniform way to all the processors. In the B2 figure, you see what is called non-uniform or NUMA memory access, because still each processor can access the whole memory space, but it will not be on the same amount of efficiency, because sometimes the memory is close to the CPU. In other cases, it needs to do some traveling inside the internal interconnect on the computer. And the platform which we see most commonly in like in my laptop, is actually maybe this kind. But when we do cluster computing, it's the hybrid model. We have both. The systems are distributed, but inside each box, it's this kind of Neumann architecture. So this means that life is complicated. To program this in effective way is completely different than to program this in effective way. Here we need maybe to know MPI only. Here we need to know only maybe OpenMP or something like that. And this is concept fits well to what is called hybrid programming, which we will not discuss in this tutorial, but modern architectures are like this. So it's both MPI and OpenMP model. Here you can see it. The situation is even more complex because we have now the accelerators, whatever, GPUs or Xeon Phi, whatever. It means that modern architecture is complicated. There are several sockets on several processors per socket. They are not uniformly inside the socket itself. I mean, the cores see the memory in different way. We have several sockets, and then we have the expansions of the accelerators. And after we pack all this, we have to go out to the neighboring computer via message passing. So it's very complicated, the environment. So this brings us to the, well, how do we do it really in practice? Oh, I'll continue. So before the break, we saw that there is a hybrid architecture of components. And when we want to write our parallel code, we need to bind the software to the hardware. So, for example, if our architecture is distributed, then natural choice will be to use message passing. The practical way to do it is with nowadays in MPI. In the previous years, it was probably more dominant by PVM. And if the architecture is shared memory, then we will use OpenMP or similar. And sometimes, there are special cases of the accelerators, and now it's the new creatures, the CUDA, OpenCL, etc. And there are also what is called PGAS languages, like UPC, and the Core Fortran, X10, and so forth. These languages are trying to do some combination of the two methods, the shared memory programming and the message passing, but they try to hide the message passing from the user, from the programmer. So they are written in a way that it's like a global memory space, although it's not localized to a single machine. But this tutorial will be focused on MPI. And I said that traditionally message passing is used on distributed machines, but it's not completely accurate because you can use MPI also on shared memory machines. It's a little bit confusing, but MPI can be used also where OpenMP is being used, in fact. But if you want to think about the concept, think about distributed memory system and MPI. Once again, the two archetypes is the shared memory, where the address space of the memory is accessible to all the processors, and the alternative concept is the distributed memory, where the memory is local to the system, and the connection is being done with message passing. And this is what we will learn now. So we're supposed to take the break here. It was close. So I will now dive deeper into MPI, which is the second part of the tutorial, actually. And the focus of this tutorial will be what is called MPI 1. It's the basic version of MPI, because MPI was upgraded twice. And And recently, there was the latest standard is MPI-3. And I think in the next tutorials, you will hear about these two. But MPI-1 is fairly rich. It has a lot of functions, and it can do a lot. So there is enough material here. And even most of the code that exists today is in fact, based on MPI-1. So both PVM, which is the parallel virtual machine, and MPI were developed in the United States. MPI was born in Argonne National Lab. And MPI is what is called API, Application Programming Interface. It's a way to do message passing, but it's not a specific implementation. You can go to the documentation and write your version for API. Or you can download open source versions like MPitch or LAM or OpenMPI. There are several. And even the commercial compilers now, Microsoft, Intel, they have also their own version of MPI because it's the source, the origin is open source, and each vendor can do its own implementation. So MPI is a software development kit. It's a way to do message passing, but we are not discussing this tutorial the specific implementation because there are some differences. As I said, MPI is considered the standard of message passing. It's the way to do parallel programming. It's the mainstream, and it is supported by C, C++, and Fortran. These are the languages of scientific computing, and MPI can run on each of the languages. There were also extensions for MPI. I mean, so there is MPI for Python, MPI for Ruby, MPI for Java, but originally it was for these languages. And as I said, MPI is fairly rich. It has more than 125 functions. We will, in this tutorial, perhaps meet the first 20 functions or something like that. And since it's open source, there's a lot of material and tutorials online. So if you want to learn further about this, you can go to my page, and from there you can find there are some links to very good tutorials. So you have a lot of reading material and that you can start from this portal. So the idea behind the MPI, well, MPI is message passing interface, is to send messages from one processor or task to another one and perhaps get back results or to exchange information via message passing. Now, MPI is a library. You, like other libraries, you need to link to MPI in order to execute your code. When you compile it, then you need to bind it to the library, and then you have the parallelization capability of your program. And the functions of that library are a somewhat high-level way to do message passing. So I would like to make a demo to you for the basic building blocks of message passing. I hope it will work. And from there, I will explain what MPI is doing as the next step. So here you see I opened two windows, and I will try to emulate two machines. Okay. So let's call this one will be called the server. This one will, I will call it client, and we'll try to make a demo about message passing. So what do we have here? Here I wrote small programs. So the first one is called server. It's in Python in this case. It's not MPI, but it's the basics. MPI is built on top of these things. And so this is the code that the server will do. And in the right side, it would be the code of the client. And what we will do here is a simple message passing. The client will connect the server and will send some information, and the information will be sent back. And I can use it. Now I'm using it locally on my laptop, but I can do it on a distributed architecture as well. It's just a matter of, a matter of specifying the IP address of the computer. Ah, okay, now you see it. Okay, so we have here what is called, it's based on TCP communication, so we need to open ports, and then we send a message. And MPI is higher level. It hides all these details, and you just write send something, receive something, but below it there are similar commands. Just to make this demo complete, so let's start here the server. So the server now is listening on a specific port, 5,000 something here, 50. This is a port number, and now I will start the client on the other terminal. And when I will hit the enter, there will be a communication. It will be very rapid between the two nodes. Okay, so I'm hitting the enter, and you see that. He said that I received hello world because hello world was sent, you see here the string, it was sent to the open socket to the other member and sent back. Now, this is the building blocks of message passing, if you like. But they did it for us. They packed everything in a high-level way. And this is what MPI can do at the lowest level, just send and receive, like we see in this slide. Some practical information for the third part later on, for the tutorial hands-on. When you write an MPI program, you always need to include the MPI .h, and all the functions of MPIs, by convention, at least in C language, they start with capital letters MPI underscore and some additional capital letter and all the rest of the name of the function and the parameters. But this is a convention, and sometimes you have bugs because you just simply used you didn't use a capital letter, so be aware of that. I recommend you to print what is called MPI reference card. It is just, I think, 2 pages. Of summaries of all the MPI commands. It's very useful. It's a short PDF file, and you can download it from here. And when we write, you remember the acronym SPMD, Single Program Multiple Data. So the way we program our cluster is from a single source file, which combines regular C commands and functions from the MPI library. So we have this include that we saw before. Then we can have declaration in the regular way we do. And when we want to do parallel code, we need to initialize the MPI environment. So there is a function called MPI init, which should be the first command of MPI. No other MPI command is allowed above this. Similarly, when we terminate the parallel computation, we use a command which is called MPI finalize, and it's not expected to use any other MPI function below that. And in between, we do the message passing, as we will see shortly. In principle, we have 3 classes of functions. Some of them are, let's call them, management routines. The other one, the other group is point-to-point. Point-to-point, I mean, there are 2 members in the communication, the sender and the receiver. Just 2, not 3, and of course not 1. And there are collective routines, which communicate all the tasks that belong to a specific family. By default, the first family in MPI is called MPI com world, which is denoted, is called communicator. And it's all the tasks that participate in the computation belong to this family. MPI com world is the default communicator. And when we will learn about collective commands, the scope of this command is on all the tasks of the communicator that is specified in the function. And this will be clear, I hope, shortly. So here, for example, is a summary of the basic MPI commands. Again, it's a little bit cut here, but they all start with MPI. So the initialization, as we saw before, com size, is important function. It returns the number of tasks that are involved in the computation. Maybe this is the point to do some clarifications about the terminology again. So let's write what we mean by all these names. There is task, there is process, there is processor, and maybe there is also thread. And sometimes, many times, we use one of them in a random way, and it's okay. But sometimes we need to be very clear what we mean. So MPI is talking about tasks. Task is the basic unit of computation of MPI, but it can be mapped as the explicit way that the computer sees it. Sometimes it can be thread, and sometimes it can be a process. Another important point to understand that there is no one-to-one relation between the number of tasks and the number of physical cores. Maybe it's the number of cores that you have in the system. In fact, all the parallel programs that we will write can run even on a serial processor. They will run, but the performance will be very, very poor, because it cannot be parallelized, but it will work. So it's also a tip for you. When you develop code, you can start on a simple laptop. You don't need a cluster for the development. Then when you want to study scalability and performance and so forth, you need to go to the target machine. But for development, initial development, you can do it even on a very modest resources, because it will run. And another point to notice is that when you want to optimize the performance, it's usually true to assume that you allocate one task to one core. If you have, for example, 8 cores, like in this computer, of course you can use 1, 2, and up to 8 MPI tasks, and it would work very good. But you can also submit a job with much more tasks than the physical cores that you have. This means that there will be the operating system will try to do its best, but it will be maybe less optimal. Depends. But again, it will run every number of tasks that you will ask until exceeding some limitation by the operating system. It will work. And therefore, you can play with any combination of cores and MPI tasks. But again, when you come to performance, then usually, one task allocated to one core is the best solution, the best choice. Okay, so I will introduce you some of the functions of MPI, and I don't expect that you will remember it now. It's not; it's a little bit late, and there is a huge amount of information here. So I will maybe get focused on the functions that are relevant to the hands-on that will come later on. And all the rest are for your reference. So I'll mention a few of the functions and not all of them in the framework of this tutorial. So for example, MPI init is a mandatory command, and I mentioned it. And the finalize is also needed as the last MPI command. When you want to measure time, and this is very common because you don't want to learn how good you do your programming, you will use timing functions like MPI wtime. If you remember in the previous hour, I showed example in MATLAB where there was a tick and talk. It's like starting and stopping a timer. So similarly, you can call this function twice and make the difference between the returned values, and you know the time it took for the code to be executed between the two calls to the MPI W time. And these two are also very important. So the comp size, as I said, is the number of tasks in the computation. Usually, in fact, it's in the communicator, but it's the number of tasks in the run in the default case. And rank is the ID number of the specific task inside the communicator or the size. So what I mean by that? Suppose I submit a computation with 10 MPI tasks. Then by convention, MPI give an ID number to each of the tasks, which start from zero, and it increments until number of processes minus one. So this will be the rank. Each process can call this function, and the return value will be the ID of the task. And the size, which is this function, will return the global number of tasks. So these... Okay. And as we saw in the Python example, the basic building blocks is the message passing, where we send some information, a variable, from one process to the other process. So what you see here is a pseudocode. It's not exact syntax of MPI, but you see here the essential arguments that are required. So first you specify what you want to send, and then the address or the name, which is the rank, of the destination. So here, for example, process 1 send X to process 2. This is why there is 2 here. And in similar way, process 2 receives a variable into Y from the sender, which is process number 1. So the basic building blocks will be of the point-to-point commands will be send and receive, MPI send and MPI receive. But there are many other variations of the send and receive. So I will not go in too much in detailed explanation about them because it will consume too much time. So there are several modes which are you need to select them according to the performance. But let's say that it's for a more advanced stage. You can start your programming with these commands, send and receive, and then when you do fine-tuning, you can maybe switch to more sophisticated versions of send and receive, like the synchronous send, and there is the immediate send, and so forth. Here, for example, there is another member of the send family, which is optimized for performance, but it's a little bit more complicated because it requires additional testing, like using such commands as MPI wait and test. So there are many variations of the basic send and receive, which we now, for now, maybe can skip. Okay, so they are summarized here, and I will not go into too much detail about them. The other kind of commands in MPI are the collective commands, as I mentioned before. And they, by their name, it means that we do message passing among several processes. And the default way to do it is to use a family name of processes, which is called MPI.com.world. It's the default name for all the processes that participate in the run. You can create sub-communicators, family of tasks, and then you assign a different name for that communicator, and then you can do collective commands to this sub-family of tasks. But the default one is the MPI.com.world, which we will use in our tutorial. And again, this means that when I specify collective command with this communicator, I mean all the tasks that I have in my run. Additional points to know, when I use collective operations, and we will shortly, I will explain a few of them, it is usually implies that the processes that participate in the collective commands are also get synchronized at that point. So if we have several processes that are running, and this is like the time, at some point, maybe there are slower and faster processes, but when I use a collective command that all of them are under the scope of this command, they will proceed from that collective command in a synchronous way. I mean, it's also a synchronization point of the processes. Of course, also collective commands that deal with data movement. This is the message passing. And here is a list of several of these collective commands. So first of all is the MPI barrier, which is a direct synchronization of processes. the goal of the barrier is just to let all the processes stop at some point. I mean, if someone is reaching this line, this point, before the other, it will wait for the last process, and then from then they all proceed synchronized. So this is the barrier. Another collective command is the broadcast, which is called one-to-many. One specific task which we choose, transmit messages to all the other tasks, and also practically also to itself, because the sender is also part of the receiving group, because it belongs to the same communicator. And there are also many other commands like scatter and gather. We will see it in a visual way soon. So this is the barrier. Okay, you see here the meaning of synchronizing the tasks. And there are many members also to the collective commands family. So gather is the opposite command to scatter. There is also all gather, which does the same as this gather, but distribute the answer to all the processes. I will show it in a second in a visual way, so you will grasp the concept. And there is another interesting collective command, which is called reduce. It's not atomic command. The atomic commands are send and receive. All the rest can be implemented using this send receive, in fact. So reduce is a complex command. It does some kind of gathering, like here, and in addition, it does some mathematical manipulation on the reduced information. And we will use one of the examples in the hands-on will be based on this MPI reduce command. So here you can maybe get the idea behind the collective commands. So let's explain them again. So the first one is broadcast. Broadcast means that we have one specific task, it is called the root, which transmits the same message to all the processes in the communicator, in this family. So this is called also one to many. The scatter is quite similar, but if the information here now is like is not a single variable, it's like a vector maybe, and then one element will go to the first process, second element to the second process, and so forth. This is scatter. And gather is quite the same, just reverse the direction of the arrows, and this is the meaning of gather. And the last one is this reduction that I mentioned before. It's like gathering information, but in addition, there is some mathematical operation. In this case, it's summation. So 16 is the sum of 1, 3, 5, and 7. Yeah, it's the 12 plus 4. So this is a gather plus additional computation, and it is a very useful command, the reduction. Here you can see for a list of, I think, most of, the, or maybe all of the operation that the reduce can do. So what we saw before is the MPI sum. It's one of the arguments of this command. And if it is specified like this, the operation on the data will be summation. But you can do also other logical and or mathematical functions on this information. Additional collective commands, the all reduce, which is similar to the reduce that we saw here, but instead of one focal point, one root, all reduce distribute this answer, this result to all the processes.
Sorry.
Yeah, sure.
The scatter, mm-hmm. You have send color sending to send color. So you can make the lower circle with many colors also like a row. So what is the meaning of the scatter?
So you can think of an array of numbers, and you just, in a single command, transfer the zero element to process zero, the first element to process one. And this...
It sends to itself. You don't
need to send it. True.
Zero,
yes.
Zero, it means
nothing. You're right. So the root to itself is maybe virtual sending. It's not real.
Send is one, but, and two, and three.
No. The other one, if the root is zero, then the first, there is no really meaning of that values. But all the rest goes via the network to the destination. So the first number will go to task number one, which can be a computer in the in a different room. And the variable number two will go to the according to the rank, the MPI rank. So as I said, all reduce is reduce, which is duplicated to the rest of the processes, and there is a reduce scatter all to all. All to all is an interesting one, but I will show you again in charts. So all reduce, or first of all, regular reduce. You see here that all the data, this is the situation before using the command and after. So we go from a situation where we have some information which is distributed in different processes, and then it is after using operating this operation, we have in the root process reduction of all this information and the mathematical operation like summation. And all reduce does the same. It then duplicates it to all the tasks. So again, if it is summation, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 is 10. And then this 10 is spread to all the tasks. This is all reduce. And there is many combinations like reduce scatter, which do partial sums. So for example, if the numbers in the task are like this, then the sum of the first number would be here, the sum of the second row would be here, the sum of the third one will go to, I mean, it's incremental effect of the command. All to all, which I mentioned before, so suppose before we use the, we operate the all to all command, this is the information that is sitting in each of the tasks, and then we use our collective all-to-all command, and the final result is this situation. And what you see here that using all-to-all is like doing a transpose on a matrix. So if the information now is in columns, then after all-to-all it is in rows. So you can do actually transpose of a matrix in a single MPI command, just call this MPI all to all, and all the parameters that should be, of course, correct. Another thing to notice about MPI is that MPI has its own data types. So there are, for example, data types in C, in Fortran, integers, float, double, etc. But MPI, in order to make the parallel programming safer, use its own types. And by that, we guarantee that we don't suffer from numerical inaccuracies. Because suppose we do message passing between two machines that are from different architecture, or maybe we compile the code on different compilers. There can be differences, and we don't want to get into troubles of when we do message passing, and then somehow we accumulate inaccuracies. So the safest way to do message passing is to use these predefined types of MPI. And maybe this is the first time we meet a real-life example in MPI. And again, this is a pseudocode. It's not something that you can do copy-paste and to the editor and then compile it. But it emphasizes the important commands that allow us to understand what is going on here. So suppose we have this situation. We have 9 processes, okay? And we want to send information from all the other eight processes to process number 0. Like is shown in this chart, in this figure. How do we implement it in MPI? So first of all, again, this is a single program, multiple data. It's SPMD. This is a single source, and from the single source file, we operate all the 9 processes in this case. So we start with some initialization. You remember that we need to include the MPI.h, and we need to call MPI init. And then there is an if statement here. And the if statement asks whether my ID or my rank is equal to 0. What does it mean? Since it's SPMD, all the 9 processes will go over the same code. But only process that knows that its rank is number 0 will get answer true for this question. So only process number 0 will enter to this block. And all the other processes will get the answer false. And so they will execute the code which starts in this block after the else. There's a missing parenthesis here. What does it mean? It means that if my rank is 0, I will do this computation, and I will enter the loop, the for loop here, which goes from source equal 1 to source less than number of processors. In this case, it's 9. So it will go from 1 to 8. And process 0 will enter this line, which is MPI receive. So it means that the processor now is in a wait state, is waiting for something to happen. What should happen here? That is that process 0 is waiting to accept some variable, which is called value, is expecting to interpret this value as a MPI float, which is a floating point number of size 1. It's a single number. It's not a vector. It's not something more complex. And it expects to receive this value from another machine which has a rank which is equal to source. This is the ID number of the sender. In addition, there is another parameter which is called tag that is used to distinguish between several sends. I want to receive only messages from the same tag. In this case, it's not so problematic. Any integer will be good. The other parameter is MPI.conWorld. As you remember, this is the family name of all the processes that participate in this execution of the job. Since it's capital letters, it's a reserved word. It's the default name for all the tasks in the computation. And the last argument is status is a return value, which we can examine later on to see if the communication went okay. So process 0 will do a loop 8 times. It will receive information, and it will accumulate it, because value is the number that will be transmitted, and it will be accumulated into this sum, which is initialized to 0 before. And in a correspondent way, since there are 8 receives, there should be 8 send commands, and they will be performed by the processes along the circle. And these machines will send value, which is defined elsewhere, somewhere above in the code. It's not written here. And again, there is a complete match between the type of the sender and the receiver. So it's a floating point number. It's a single number. And the address of the destination is 0. This is the rank, the MPI rank of the receiver. And again, tag, which should be compatible with this number. And again, the family name. This is a mandatory in both point-to-point and collective commands. And here come the right parentheses, and then we finalize, and we can end the computation. So this simple code is our first example of MPI code, which is also a demonstration of the concept which is called master worker, because we... maybe in an arbitrary way, we choose one of them, process 0, to be different from the other processes. So it's like a master. It's doing something special, and all the rest do the same computation, and they are called, in this example, workers. And this is a very important concept in parallel computing, master worker. Many times you nominate a master, one of the processes that will do for you, for example, the input-output, the dialogue with the user, writing, opening files. You don't want a million processes maybe to open files, you do it only on the master.
There's only one master.
Well, the name it depends. I mean, you can do whatever you like, but there are sometimes that you can do hierarchy of masters. You can build a tree, and there is a headmaster, and then maybe lower rank masters. You can do it. It depends on the problem.
Can you do it without any
masters? Sometimes you can. Yes, it's not mandatory. Not all MPI programs are in this concept, for sure. Now, later on, we do a numerical computation of integration. It's the last part of the tutorial, which will follow this concept of master worker. So this is an important case study. Another issue that we need to pay attention when we go when we program parallel code in MPI and in other ways also is to beware of what is called deadlock. A deadlock is a situation where one computer, in order to proceed, need some resource from another computer, which depends on another one. And so this dependency can cause the computation to halt. And it's you need to kill the job, actually. You cannot do it. It's stuck, and then it is not programmed well. It's your responsibility to write the code differently. So, for example, if you go back here, we can... Well, this is safe programming, but there are situations that we can, even in a simple example like this, create deadlocks. It depends also. Okay, so it is written here, end of part two, but it's a little bit arbitrary because I skipped many of the commands. I will proceed now to more detailed examples that in the last hour we will do the practice. So again, this is the alternative maybe website for the tutorial. But the important thing here is that all the examples of the last section can be downloaded from here. So there is a compressed tar file, which is called Prest 2014 MPI, that you can download with the command wget. All these practical details we will leave to the last hour. But it's for your information. It's written here. And all the examples will be in C. And during the tutorial, we'll do several programs, let's say from the most easy one to more complex at the end. And I hope that you are familiar with basic Linux, because Linux is the platform that we will do the hands-on. And in fact, Linux is the best way to learn parallel computing is on Linux machines. And if you look at the distribution of operating systems at the top 500, you see the complete dominance of Linux on its several flavors, maybe, but Linux is the nearly 100% of the top 500. So maybe the first machine, the Chinese machine, is a Chinese version of Ubuntu, and there are many CentOS machines and Red Hat and SUSE. So Linux, but all Linux and not Microsoft. Okay, so when we go to do our hands-on, we will, like a typical code development, we'll start by using some editor to write our code. You can, in this case, the code is ready for you, but you can make changes, so you need to use some kind of editor. VI is a good choice when you don't have graphics. And when we are happy with the code that we develop, we save it, and then we go to the compilation stage. And if you are familiar with Linux, you probably know that there is also a free compiler in all the Linux distributions, which is called GCC. It's the GNU C compiler. And when you compile your code, you specify the name of the binary file that you want to generate and the source file and flags for the optimization and so forth. And similarly, the same syntax applies when you want to compile this code in C with MPI. Just replace the GCC with the command MPICC, assuming that MPI is already installed in your system. But there is some delicate point here. MPICC is not a compiler. It's a script that calls GCC and adds the right flags and pointers to the places of the libraries and the include files. So it's just a matter of ease of use. You can compile your MPI code directly with GCC, but you will need to work harder. So the recommendation is to use MPICC, and then -O is a flag that tells the compiler that this is the name of the executable that I want to generate, and this is the source file that I just edited before. And assuming that that stage went smoothly, we have now a binary file which we can execute. And in order to execute this code with n processes, we will use the command MPI run, and then a flag -np for number of processes, and this will be replaced by a number, so suppose 10 processes of this binary file that was produced by the compiler. Now, this way of execution is a very good way to execute the code in parallel, but this code will run on the local machine only. So if I have, for example, here 8 cores, and I will specify here maybe 8, then under fair conditions, each of the processes will be executed on a different core, and I can be very happy on with that. But this is not a distributed computing yet, because it's on the local machine. When I want to run on a cluster on different machines, then I need to add here another argument, which is called machine file, and we will see it here. So if I want to make my code run on different machines on the cluster, and this will be the situation in the tutorial later on, in the hands-on, then I add this flag, minus machine file, and then I specify a name of a file, which is a text file, where every line or every entry in this file is a name of machine that I want to allow it to participate in the parallel run. So suppose I have a cluster with 5 nodes, N0, N1, until N4. So I just write the names of the machines in this file, which is called machines.txt, but this name is arbitrary. You can, whatever name you choose. And then when I use the command MPI run, it will be really a parallel distributed computation. It will be in parallel, and it will the task will be spread among these machines that are specified in the machine file. Now, this way of submitting programs is interactive way. You sit by the computer, you type MPI run, you hit enter, and the job is getting executed and is very good. But what happened if we are not the single user of the system? Suppose it's a departmental cluster, there are many users, so it's not the right way to do it like that, because you don't know if the resources are allocated for you. Maybe there are other computations already being executed at that time, and you will not enjoy the performance of the parallel machine because several resources are being already used. So the right way to do it when you are not a single user is to use a helping tool, which is called batch queuing system, which manage for all the users the priority and the allocation of resources in the system. And there are many tools like that, Sloan, Torque, PBS, LSF, and others. And what I will show in the hands-on is the usage of PBS. Actually, these are very similar. This is the free open source implementation, and PBS is a portable batch system. is taken care by a commercial company. But batch queuing system is a queue for holding the jobs until the resources are getting available for you. And this is the right way to run when you're not a single user. Okay, so example number one. Again, it's a little bit, we miss here a few characters, but it's not so important. The first assignment that you will be asked to do is just simple hello world. And you can see here the serial version versus the parallel version. I try to put the lines more or less in the same place. Just simple printing. But as you remember, this is a SPND. It's a single program that being executed by all the processes. So we expect that although there is a single printf in this code, it will be done by according to the number of processes that we asked in the MPI run command that we send the job on the operating system level. So if I use MPI run with minus NP and 10, for example, I expect to have to see 10 lines of printf. But the printing will be different because inside you get the rank. The rank is a specific ID number. It will not be the same printing. It will be 10 printings with different ranks and different processor name. And another interesting thing to note about this program is that when you get the printout, the 10 printf lines, you will notice that the order they come is somewhat arbitrary. It's not maybe we expect by some intuition that the first printing will be by rank 0 and then rank 1 and then rank 2 and so forth, but it's not the case. It is based on first arrived, first served. So each time we will send this one to this code to execution, we will see different order of the printout. And it's okay. It's not a bug. It's a feature of the of MPI. So this will be maybe the reference program and the parallel hello world. And with that, we will start after the next break. Then we will do a program which to get familiar with the send and receive. So this is the first part of the program. The second part will be in the next slide. We will actually this MPI com rank and com size will appear in every MPI program because we need the information of the rank or the ID number of the specific process and the total number of processes. So this will appear. It's quite general. It will appear in all the examples. But then we will continue and. Since it's a point-to-point demo, we will need only and exactly two processes in this command, a sender and receiver. And you see here the send and the corresponding receive. It's like the processes on the ring. And you see here the destination is rank 1 because it's sent from process 0 and the receiver. The receiving process, which is number 1, is receiving for process 0. And the tag in this case is 0 in both cases, in both places. So this will be example number 2. The next example is a little bit more complicated. It's what is called ping pong. It's sending back and forth a message between two processes. And even there is a check here. If the number of processes is different than 2, then it will warn you that you need to send a run with exactly 2 processes. And the computation will be aborted because it needs only 2 processes to send and receive the message between them. Make the demo of all the codes later on. So let me proceed to the next example that we will do. This is called ring. Again, it's a very classical example. In this case, what we will do is we can imagine our processors sitting on a ring, and they do message passing from one to the other until it gets back to the origin, which is rank 0 in this case. And again, the first part of the program is very standard, like we saw before. So there's nothing new here. But here it is getting a little bit more complex. Why it is getting more complex? Because when we do such a thing, we are always concerned about the deadlocks that I mentioned before. Suppose that there is a receive coming before the matching send. In this case, we might get into a deadlock, and all the computation will be stopped. So this program is written very carefully in a way that it will not happen. Maybe it's worth going into more detail in this case. So, for example, here, there is an if statement here. We check that the rank is different from zero. So let's say that this is rank zero, okay? For all the other processes, I start with a receive. So it sounds maybe alarming. Maybe it's a potential deadlock. But let's see. If the rank is not one of these, that is, it's rank zero, I initialize some token that I want to pass between the nodes, and I send it. The destination of this message is from rank number zero, because it's the complementary part of the if, and the address is the rank plus one. And there is also check that because it's in a ring, I always need to normalize it to the number of processes in the ring. So there is a division here by the word size. But I send it, let's say I send it to the neighbor which is right to me, to this one. Okay? This is this send. And in addition, the final command here is a receive, which belongs to the root of this computation. And this is located here in order to verify really that I completed the whole circle. Well, maybe let's see a demo how this is it will look in real life. So I will do all the stages for you, and then after the break you'll do it yourself. So first thing is to notice is that I have this program here. Well, it's here. It's exactly the same code that you see on the slide now. And the first step is to compile it. So I call the wrapper, which calls to GCC, and it's called MPICC. And I specify the name of the executable, which would be ring. And I specify the name of the source. Okay, so if I do a check, you see here that this file was created right now, and this is my executable. Now I want to execute it with MPI run. Okay, so let's first send it with wrong number of tasks, let's say four processes. I mixed it with the ping pong example. This is okay. And you see here the result. This was our token, and it moves from one to the other. Now, the way this program is written will reconstruct the same output each time. It does the same thing, but again, there is a race on the printf. And this is what I want to show you, that the order can change. Not the result. The results are always the same. The physics is invariant on the way we program. But printf can look different. Okay, so this will be the ping pong example. Yeah.
I didn't understand. understand why the printf is different. If the printf appear only after the MPI receive, which is like a barrier for each specific process, he cannot print because he received the token. So it should be.
No, but there is another printf here.
This printf.
Yeah, and there is here. Yeah.
This is only for the last one. After
yes.
The last one received.
Well. This is one of the surprises with printf. I can show you also.
Maybe it's all on.
Maybe.
No, it's all on the on a buffer.
Let's see. Maybe the more basic example, which was the hello MPI. Now, I hope you will. See here that it's different, not, well, it depends, but sometimes you see that there is a different order, and this is typical. Sorry?
Better chance if you use a bigger
sample. Yeah, I can know. By the way, I will. This is something that I discussed before. I can write here even. Ask for number of tasks which is larger than the number of physical cores that I have here, and it will run. Maybe it will be less efficient, but it will run. So you can always feel free to use any number actually you would like, and it will do the job. Okay. So the next example is the integration to compute numerical estimation of pi. Now pi can be computed by integrating this function between 0 and 1. So when we do integration, what we actually compute the area which is below the curve. And so if this is the function, we can divide this range between 0 to 1 to small rectangles and just sum the area of these rectangles, and this will be our approximation to pi. The more channels that we will use, the better the approximation will be. And since we are in parallel computing tutorial, we want to allocate different channels to different processors. So the summation will be performed in parallel, and then therefore we expect to get some speed up relative to serial computation. So we can divide, if you have four processors, like in this example, we can decide that between 0 to 0.25, all the channels of the computation will go to process number 0, and then number 1, and then again 0. Or it can be 3 and 4. This way is the circular decomposition that we showed before. So and the numerical scheme itself is not so important. It can be rectangles, it can be maybe trapezoids or whatever. But the idea here that we do at the same time several computations in order to accelerate reaching the estimation to pi. Before that maybe. So this function is our approximation or the way to estimate pi. But interestingly, you can notice that we can estimate pi in a different way. If we take we draw a circle with a radius which is equal to 1. We can also make integration on the function which is 1 minus x squared between 0 and 1. This is also estimation to pi over 4. So we have two ways to do it. If we just can replace this function by the unit circle, and we have two ways to choose in order to do our estimation. And this is, by the way, a nice tool which is called SAGE. It's like Mathematica and Maple, if you know. It's a numerical, mathematical, symbolic computations, but it's open source based on Python. And I recommend it for you to try. It's SageNotebook.org. And here you see the difference between the two functions, but the area is the same, is equal to pi over 4. This is to show that it's the same area. Okay, so about this program, how do we do it? So here is the function that we want to integrate. Okay, like in the slide before, 1 over 4 is over 1 plus a squared. This will be our function. We have for our reference to check our accuracy, pi with 25 digits written here. And again, the first commands of MPI, which we saw before, the rank and size and processor name, these will appear everywhere in the initialization. And then we continue here. And well, what you don't see here is that this number is the number of channels that we want to do over the integration. I mean, the region between 0 and 1 is divided, in this case, to 10 million. Let's try. Okay, now you see it. Okay. So we start the computation by broadcast. Our master, which decides on this number of channels, need to distribute this information to the rest of the processes. So it does a broadcast, which is a collective command, and n is this number, which is an integer. It is broadcast from the root, it's process number 0, to all the threads, all the processes. So now they know how many channels are in this, exercise. Later on, the width of each channel is just 1 over n. This is called h. We initialize the summation, sum equal to 0, and then we start the computation. This is the CPU intensive part of the program. The higher n, the larger n, the more computation we will have to do it. At some point, you will see that parallel computing is the only way to do it in a reasonable time. So we decide on the coordinate x. X is the coordinate, which is just the channel ID number minus half, because it is shifted by, we want to do the computation in the middle of the channel, so there is a movement of half. And then we multiply it by the width, and this is the coordinate where we want to compute the function. So now we call f. F was defined in the previous slide. And we accumulate it. Now again, this is SPMD code, so all the processes do the same. But how do we avoid the same computation by all the processes? It is the answer is here. The initialization of the loop is different. Each process gets the MyID as the seed or the initial channel of the integration. And since I jump here, I increment I by the number of processes, there is no overlap. I don't do double counting. So if the range of channels is like this, so process 0 will get this channel, and then it will skip by n prox, which is the number of processes, to another channel and another channel. And similarly, the other processes will sum or add together different channels, but there will be no overlap in the summation. So the trick is here. The initialization of the loop is a function of my ID, and then we skip and we do it in steps of number of processes. So after exiting this loop, I have each of the processes has its own contribution to the global sum. It is called MyPy. It's just this sum that I computed before, and since it's area, I need to multiply it once again by the width, because it's height times the width. This is the dimension, right dimensions. And my pi is the approximation of each of the processes to the global pi. So how do I get the final result? I need to use a collective command. From the previous slide, you see the reduce. What this command does? Well, I take the MyPy, which is the approximation of pi by each of the processes, and I accumulate it into another variable which is called pi, which is a single number in double precision, with the operation MPI sum, which means that all the reductions are being added together, and the root is ID number 0. This is the rank of the master. And again, the MPI-COM world, which appears everywhere in our examples. So after executing these collective commands, where all the processes participate in this command, I can now have the information of the global approximation to pi in the master. So I ask the master to do the final printout, and he says that pi is approximately whatever the result is. You see, this is the same pi. And there is also the accuracy, which is the absolute difference between pi and the hardwired pi, which was above the 25 digits. So this is a measure of the accuracy. And we skipped that before, but there is a timer in this computation. If I go to the previous slide, there is some MPIW time somewhere. No, the start time is just to initialize it. Maybe it's still here. Ah, here it is, yeah? You see? It is called twice, and it's important to notice that only the master is doing the timing. We want a single measurement by the master. And so here the timer is initialized, here it is stopped, and then it prints just the difference. And this is our measurement of the computation time. It's important to say here a word of caution about MPIW time. If you want to do measurements, it's not wise to put this timer on operations which are related to input-output, because hard disks, for example, are by far many orders of magnitude slower than the CPU, and you will be dominant by the noise and not by the signal. You are interested in the computation time and not the external operations which are not directly related to the computation. So you need to put the timing in the right places where the heart of the computation takes place, and not globally in the first line and the last line of the code, and because you will probably get lost by different numbers. Okay, and after that, we close the MPI environment and we terminate, we exit the program. So this is the CPI program. I wish. Yeah? Yeah, you are right. Yes. Yes, you're absolutely right. The question was if there is a really need for this broadcast, because here it is already defined for all the processes, and you're absolutely right. The origin of this program was somewhat different. It was interactive code that only the master was making communication with the user, and then there was a point really to distribute it with broadcast. But in this case, really, you can just erase this line. It's a good comment, yes. So let's see how this program behaves when we try to really execute it. So again, first step is to compile the program. We call it CPy, and the source is cpy.c. And we have now the executable. I choose some number of tasks. Doesn't matter so much here. And I specify the name of the executable. And that's it. So you see here it was running. Again, the printf is not in the right order, right? But this execution was locally on my laptop. Later on, we will do it on the Euclid cluster, and then we will do it in really distributed computing environment. Okay. Another example of closely related to the previous example is different kind of integration. It is called Monte Carlo integration, and the name Monte Carlo is always associated with computations which are based on random numbers. And the idea behind this example is to try to measure the area of the circle using random numbers. And the concept, maybe you are familiar with it, but I will say explain it in a few words here. Okay, so what we like to do is we draw a circle again of radius equal to 1. It's better, it's easier to explain. And this circle is bounded by a square of the same well, the side now of the square is 2, of course. And we know the area of the square is just 2 by 2, right? So the area of the square is 4. And if we now play a game and we saw random dots on the square, which distribute uniformly, it's important here that the distribution will be uniform. No preference in each, in any direction. So if we start to throw dots on the square, parts of several of them will be inside the circle and others will be outside the circle. But if we count all the points that fall inside the circle, then the ratio between this number of points to the overall number of points we generated in the square is approximation to the ratio of the area of the circle to the area of the square. Now, since the area of the square is 4, as we saw before, and since the radius of this circle is 1, and the area of a circle is pi r squared, then the area of the circle is pi, because the r is equal to 1. So by knowing the ratio between the points, the overall number of points generated to the points that fell inside the circle, we get pi over 4, estimation to pi over 4, so we know we can calculate pi also. Okay? So here is a serial program that make this computation. No MPI in this pseudocode. I just decide how many points I want to throw on the square. The more points, the better accuracy I will get. So in this case, it's 10,000 points. And I initialize a counter for the points that fall inside the square. And I generate two independent, it's important, two independent random numbers for the x and y coordinate in order to find the location of that random point. And I ask the question if it's inside the circle or outside. If it's inside, I increment the counter. And when I'm done with the loop, I just divide the counter to the total number of points. And this is my approximation to pi. Now, since there is a very important point here that the random numbers are not correlated. If they are correlated, they are not random. So I can very easily parallelize it because I can give different MPI tasks to do the same computation. They will, each process will have its own random numbers, and I can choose now or to get a bigger sample by using many processes, and then the accuracy will be better, or to finish the computation faster because I will divide the 10,000 points to more tasks than a single task. The only thing I need to be very careful here is that I need to generate the numbers from different seed. You know, there are not computers that cannot generate really random numbers. They do pseudo-random numbers. So in order not to reconstruct the same sequence of random numbers, I need to start the sequence of the numbers in each process by a different seed. So, for example, the seed for this series of numbers can be the rank of the process. And then I am safe that the seed is different between the processes. And I can move from serial to parallel in a very straightforward way. So here is an example, and we will take a break soon. Okay, so I will explain the code and then we'll take a break. So what we have here is a helper program, which is called DBoard. And deals with this is the first part of this code. It just deals with the generation of the coordinates, x and y. And then it checks if this is inside the unit circle. And then it increments the counter. Okay, and there is an additional program here which is called PyReduce that accumulates all the previous code from all the processes So let's assume that we have 5,000 points or dots that in this game, and we do it this is the initial run, and then we will increment the number of dots in several intense steps. You will see it in a minute. Then all we have to do is call the function dboard that was defined before, and this will be some kind of a local pi, and then we and I skip the details. We use again some reduce command to get the accumulated number, but then we need to normalize it by the number of processes in order to get the right pi. Any practical remark about this code? When you will download the assignments, you will see that there is a single file here which is called the makefile. Okay? And the makefile, I don't have enough time to explain it, but makefile is the more advanced way to build a code where you have more than one source. And so in order to generate the executable now, we need to call these two programs that I showed in the presentation slide, where CC is the name of the MPICC. So if you want to build the code, you just need to write make instead of MPICC, and it will create the program for you. So let's see it, how it looks. Oops. So I just, well, in this case, there will be nothing to do, but I call this pyreduce. It's up to date. I can remove it. Maybe. Never mind. After I created this program, pyreduce, I simply, again, call MPI run. I can select the number of processes. And this is what I expect to see. So we start with 5,000 dots, and I increment it 10 times. And I see that the accuracy is getting improved. And this is the PI assignment with Monte Carlo. Now, the time is running, so what we will do now, we will go to break, but before we leave to the break, if there are people here in the audience that still have problem to connect to the Euclid, it's the time to solve the problem. So there are people that will assist you to do the connection to the Euclid cluster using the SSH. I guess you heard about it, okay? Before we go to the end-zone, I would like to have your attention for a couple of more slides, and then we will proceed. So, there is another example in the package that you will download, which is a very complex, complicated example, and I think we will not have time to go into it. This program deals with the parallel computation of a real scientific problem, which is the heat equation. But I think we will not have time to go into details. But I would like to say a few words which in the context of that program make sense, but they are also more very general. And you remember that we said that we need to optimize the ratio between computation and communication. And usually the situation is that when we add more processors, we do the computation faster, so the time it takes declines. On the other hand, there is a trade-off. When there are more processors, there are more communications, and this rises. And we are looking for the optimal time. So it's the sum of the two components, and it's usually somewhere between. And this is a quite general conclusion. It's relevant to this assignment, but it's completely general. So there is always an optimum, which comes from the computation and the communication times. And once again, you see here two alternative partitions of the domain, which can be strip or block or square block. I mentioned that before. In case that we do strip decomposition, then at the up and down sides, we have the boundaries. So there is no message passing to the boundaries. But if it's an internal strip, then there are message passing to the right and to the left. Two sends, one left, one right, and two receives in each iteration. So overall, in this topology, there are four communications, you see here. So the communication time is four times the latency, which is the T startup, and the message size, which is the size of this block, which is, let's say, it's N. So this will be the communication time in case of division by strips. If we divide the problem, do the domain decomposition into blocks of size N divided by the square of the number of processors, if we have P processors on a domain which is N by N, then each side is N divided by square root of P. But in this case, assuming that this is an internal block, we have four neighbors. So we have eight communications, four sends and four receives. And so the number of communication now is doubled compared to this topology. On the other hand, the size of the message is now smaller because the size of this block is N divided by square root of P. So we need to send less information. And we have the challenge to decide which is best. So in this case, this one looks good because we have only four latencies, but we send larger packet, larger message. And here we have eight times startup, eight times latency, which is sounds not so good, but then we deliver or we send and receive shorter messages. Now there is no right and wrong here. And in some constellation, you can draw a line where it is best to choose one topology instead of the other one. But this is always a question how to do it right, and it depends on the network, as you can see, and it depends on the problem. And final remark about this point, this example is the topic of the ghost points, which we mentioned before. This is the origin of the intensity of the computation of the communication. The need to supply the boundary information to the different processes. Now, if you go to the code, there is one of the examples is called 1D.C, and this example deals with this kind of computations of neighboring processors and ghost points. But since the code is quite complex, we will not have time, I think, to do it in a more detailed way. Now, some practical remarks. We will do our tutorial on the Euclid cluster. So here are screenshots how to do it. First of all, you need to log in to connect. You do it by SSH. Okay, so I guess each of you has a username. And you do this command, SSH, this is my account, and then I'm inside, I'm connected. So, as the first step, I recommend you to create a directory to do all the assignments in a specific directory. If you are not familiar, you can write makdir with some name, and then you change the directory, you go to work in that directory. And you can download the assignments to the directory that you just created. Now, since it's quite common that clusters have different environments and different versions of compilers and different versions of MPI and different layers of communication, it can be Ethernet, it can be InfiniBand. So in order to be exact and to know which package, which stack you are using, there is a concept which is called module that help us to select and to choose the right environment for our needs. So, for example, in the Euclid cluster, you can see that there are many, many available modules from different type of settings. You can see the list of available modules, what already is loaded. But for our assignment, I recommend you to do this command. You just can copy and paste it to the terminal that you are working. This will make you make accessible to you the OpenMPI, which is one of the flavors of MPI, and the right combination of MPI and the GNU compiler. And after that, you can work like I showed in the examples. You do MPI CC, MPI run, and everything will work for you very good. So when you log in, the next step is to download the exercises. So you just here it is written wget. I guess you see it in your slides. This is the way to download this package. So just copy paste or make it even click on this, and you will get this package in your system, in your account. The next step is to uncompress it, to make it to see the source files. So you type something like tar zxf and the name of this package, and you get all the assignments ready for you. And then I recommend you to do it as I show in the slides, to start with the simplest ones, the hello serial and the hello parallel. Well, this is a mistake here. Never mind the name MPI, and it should be just MPI. And then go to maybe to the ping pong and the ring, and then CPI and the Monte Carlo. If you have any problems, then we are here to help you with that. So here again, you see example of executing the CPI program. This is the compilation. This is the execution. And this is, again, on the local machine, okay? Because I didn't specify here any machine file. This is, in this case, four tasks of MPI, but running locally on the node that I'm connected now. If I want to do it really parallel on several different machines, then I need to specify the machine file, and here are the names of the available machines on the cluster. So you need to create a machine file. The name here, again, is arbitrary. I chose to call it machines, but you can call it whatever you like. And in the editor, you just write line by line the name of the machines, and you save it. These are the instructions for the VI editor. It works, but it works locally, as I said. If you do it like this, then you run locally. Okay, so it's fine. So this is the machine file, and as I said, this is now the execution with the machine file, and it is running on different machines.
Load it completely on the OpenMPI completely on the command line, capital H, and then the names of the hosts.
Right. Yes. There are alternative ways. Yes, without my right. And the last step will be to do the same, but using a batch queuing system, in this case the Torque, and then you don't need to submit the job interactively, you submit it to the Torque system, and when the Torque identifies that the resources are available, in this case you are asking for four nodes with four processors per node. This is a script that is submitted instead of the direct MPI run. You submit this file, which is in this case is called run.share. Okay, you submit it with a specific command for the talk. So before that, you can use this command pbs node to see information about the available nodes in the pool, and then you submit it with a command qsub. This is the name to submit jobs to the scheduler, to the batch queuing system. And if you will be quick enough to type qstat, you will see the status of the job. And then, since you are not running now interactively, you will find the answer not printed to the screen, but printed to a file. So if you want to see the output of your program, it will not be printed directly to you. You will see it. If you will type ls, you will find something like that. You will have different numbers. And then you can examine the output by, it's a text file, you can view it with an editor or just type cut or more or something like that. And here is the output. In case you will have errors, you will have similar notation, but instead of output, you will see the letter E for errors. And hopefully you will not have errors. So this is the recommended way to work when we are a multi-user environment at the moment. And then if you type more, and as I said, examine the output, you will see the same output that you expected to get when you run interactively in the command line. So I just skipped a little bit from the printout because it's very long. You remember I asked for four processes in, per node, and there are four nodes or something like that. I don't remember. So the output is quite long. So this is typical output for the program, so you can compare if you get similar files. Okay? So this concludes the slides. Again, the tutorial is updated and is available from this link. There are some references to MPI. You can find them here. And this is the tutorial, the hands-on assignments in this file. And we will now start to do it. If you have any problems, please raise your hand. We will try to help you. And if you have questions, I will be happy to answer. So let's go do the assignments.